Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Wired Nerdy Podcast. This is episode number, where are we at, Doug? 18? Is that
right? Yeah, 19,
I think. 19! See, yay, Doug's got to keep me straight. Nice. Yeah. He saw it. He has the countdown. This is Keith. This is Doug. Hope everyone's doing well. Doug, how does, 19 treat you? Boy, these are clicking right along.
Yeah, doing good. I think we've got some really good articles and then a discussion that I'm kind of excited about. You mentioned this discussion. I won't give it away. Spoiler alert, it's not here. And it really, you know, it sent me on a wild goose chase, I guess you could say, of going down the history of it and everything. But before we get too far into that, let's get into some nerd news, right?
Nah, let's cue it up, man. I can tell you're excited about that main thing. So let's do the nerd news. Cue it up.
Yeah. Nerd news.
All right, I'm gonna get the share going here. And what's funny is, like, we talk about how there's slow weeks sometimes. I think this might have been one of them. Slower. And don't get me wrong, there's always news, but some of it's stuff we've already reported on, and we always want to have new stuff for you guys.
Yeah, you know, we've talked a lot, we're in season 2, episode 19, about Steam sales, but they keep grabbing our attention. You know, we have our wish list, and some days it may be on sale, but we're not ready to pull the trigger. So Steam is having a sale again. I've seen some stuff pop up on my list. I may pull the trigger, but it's safe in my wish list, I guess.
I've already added stuff off my wish list, because I go all throughout the year adding stuff to my wish list, and I've already threw some things in my cart. And I think I mentioned before, I get gift cards for, like, birthday and Christmas. Yeah. So I collect all throughout the year, and then I cash out at the summer sales. So I'm going to pick up some good ones. You know, it's one of those things where I buy a lot of stuff that I don't get around to playing. I'm going to admit that. I collect digital games, but at least if I'm hoarding Steam games, they don't take up space. You know, physically.
Yeah.
So, and now that I know I can use my Apple TV and stream to my living room, maybe I'll work on that back catalog.
Yet the thing we should talk about in the future is digital collections. Do you actually own it forever?
Ooh, that's a good conversation. Boy, that could get deep.
So we'll talk about that later. Just a thought there.
Well, one of the big callouts that The Verge has is that Baldur's Gate 3, which we talked about, you know, that game before, it's very impressive. It's really the best interpretations of a pen and paper Dungeons and Dragons game into a video game. And it is at its cheapest it's ever been, at $48, because it's been hovering at $60. Did you pick this up yet? I can't remember if we talked about this.
It's definitely in my list. I'm excited about it. I really like some of the stuff I've seen where it is like D&D. You know, we had a short D&D session. We didn't really get into it like I wanted. I definitely want to get back to that, and I definitely want to check this out.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you should try it out. It's a really good introduction to D&D if you're not used to it, especially with it being a video game. They did a great job with it. And a lot of people were mad at the developers because they announced that they're not going to do a continuation, like a Baldur's Gate 4. So they're just like, you know what? We want to move on to a different IP. They did so good with this one. I think they don't want to get pigeonholed, if you will, into one type, which I kind of admire that. Larian Studios is the ones who made it. So.
Yeah.
All right. This was interesting. So Mr. Mark Zuckerberg, he was on a podcast this past week. Now, I didn't watch this thing within its entirety by any means, but apparently he dropped a lot of crazy things. Now, between him and Elon Musk, it seems like every day they're saying something more and more crazy about the future predictions and that sort of thing. I think not too long ago, Elon Musk was talking about how everybody's going to have universal basic income and that AI is going to put everybody out of the job. It's always something, right? And with this one, Zuck here hinted at they're almost ready. They, as in Meta, are almost ready to showcase a new set of glasses that are true holographic glasses, which I will say is definitely different compared to all the VR stuff that we've been seeing. I'm curious about this. I don't know. What are your thoughts about holograms, man?
You know, Google Glass, I believe that's the name of it. That was probably more than 5 years ago. The Vision Pro with Apple. You just kind of wonder what the feature set is to justify the purchase. So the one thing I think we're going to look at big time is the purchase price. Because you know that Vision Pro is what, $4,000 or something?
Rumors are, though, they're working on a cheaper version of the Vision Pro.
Oh, nice. Nice.
Now, it's $3,500. What's cheaper? Half of that?
Yeah.
It's still pretty steep, even if you go half. So, yeah, you're now, right.
Getting into some of the stuff I would love to see with a truly holographic pair of glasses is, you know, text translation. Yeah. Going there, or if I look at a product in the store, see like the nutritional facts or something like that, or look at a movie poster, it'll pop up a trailer for me. Something cool like that. I mean, that's just thoughts right off the top of my head, nothing prepared. So
it's not full on, it's more AR, augmented reality. Okay. It's what more that is. But I did see something reminding me of you. There is a pair of glasses that you can put on as augmented reality that if you're hearing impaired, in real time, it uses AI chip that's in the glasses, and it puts subtitles below the person.
Oh, no, I would actually buy that. Subtitles. I have subtitles on YouTube, on all my devices. And
this TV. Is subtitles in real life, man. Isn't that so cool? Yeah,
that would be great. I may not want to know what everybody says to me. You know.
Well, and I can only imagine it could work in with translations. Imagine wearing these glasses, you know. You know, they walk past somebody in Italy and they're like, stupid American. So it could be cool. Anyway, back to this. We don't know what the prototype is. He claims it's full holographic. I don't know if we've ever seen that. Our only idea of holograms is what we've seen thus far inside of movies and televisions like the holodeck on Star Trek and things of that sort. So this will be interesting. It just sounds like something definitely different than what we've seen so far between augmented reality and virtual reality.
Absolutely.
All right. This next one, you got this. This is interesting.
Yeah, you know, it wouldn't be an episode of Wired Nerdy if we didn't talk about a little AI. So the latest big announcement, I guess, in AI is Peacock is going to unveil some personal Olympic recaps. So they're not going to do live coverage of an Olympic event. But I believe they're going to use an AI-generated person, a.k.a. Al Michaels, the late, great Al Michaels, I believe.
Did Al Michaels pass away?
Or maybe not late, great? Sorry,
Al. I don't know. I'm not a sports guy. I know who Al Michaels is.
Yeah.
I know who he is. Very famous. I know the voice. It's iconic. I'm not even a sports guy. I know that. But I'm asking if he passed away just because, like, did he? I mean...
He's still alive, so my apologies to Al
Michaels. I was going to say, what happened, man?
So, you know, because you always hear about posthumous, honors with AI and stuff. So that's kind of where I thought I was going. But Al Michaels has gifted his presence, his voice, to being an AI recap of some of the Olympic events. I kind of got mixed feelings with this. Is he too busy or what, you know? But
I don't know. Think about it, man. I mean, he doesn't have to take time out to read the script. As long, I'm sure he has legal agreements to where they have to limit what he says with, you know, so he doesn't hurt his brand already. Yeah. Think about this though. He's already been in games like Madden. Can you imagine like classic announcers, like with Howard Cosell? Can you imagine if they took old voices like that and then put them in modern games? It would be interesting. So I do see it. The cool thing about it, it locks him in that once he's retired and not doing this anymore, his voice can live on and still do sports announcing. It's kind of interesting. Although I feel bad for it. You think about these moments of like, what if you are a young up and coming sports announcer and you want to be the next Al Michaels, but you can't because his AI voice has pretty much dominated the market and there's no job for you.
Yeah.
I mean, there's all these things, right? It's like, well, we don't need another Al Michaels. We still have him in AI form. We're just going to keep using it for the next 100 years.
Yeah, you know, Al Michaels AI is probably cheaper than Al Michaels human.
I'm sure it is. That's why they probably did it. I'm sure you got a fat check. But
so when we get famous, we apologize to the Al Michaels family for saying he was dead.
Yeah. Hey, we fact check real time. That's better than a presidential debate. I can tell you that.
All right.
You know the difference between the presidential debate and Wired Nerdy?
No.
We're not a dumpster fire.
And the hits keep coming. All right.
All right. Let's keep rolling.
All right. The next one.
This is a good one. Yeah.
Yeah. Another AR thing. augmented reality using some AI. It looks really cool. So this is a set of smart binoculars that can identify thousands of stars and over a million landmarks. So I believe just by looking at them.
That's awesome. Now, they had something like this with your phone, your iPhone, and with your Android.
Yeah.
Like an app, right?
Google had SkyMap, or I don't know the name of it, but Google had, one.
Yeah.
You would hold it up in the sky, and it would get your location, GPS, and tell you the constellation.
I used one, and it's really cool. It's neat.
It works great,
But in binoculars, I wondered, like, besides stars, what else? Like, does it says that if you're in a iconic area, what does that mean if you're at like the Grand Canyon?
Yeah. Now, going down in the article, it also talks about recognizing certain types of birds and animals.
Really?
It will have the ability to label over a million unique landmarks, including mountains, trails, and 200,000 objects in the night sky.
That is freaking cool.
It is really cool.
It's got Bluetooth and it's got GPS and other sensors to determine where the user is located with the help of an So it's geo mapped, so it knows where you are in the earth. You know how cool this would be for like explorers and
You know, I just gasped because I looked down. Users can look onto a target, then lock it in with the binoculars. And hand it to someone, then the binoculars will guide them to that same target.
Oh my gosh.
That
I love
is
it.
Amazing right there. So what I'm talking about is for hunters.
Oh
if
my
you're
God.
With
yeah.
a young hunter that's having some trouble,
you
look at the deer, turkey, bird, whatever, lock it in, you hand it to your young hunter, and it directs them right to where to go.
Genius, man. That's
that right there is amazing technology.
I like that. Who would have thought? Modernizing something as old as binoculars. Look at that. They even show, we're showing the video right now. And if you look at a mountain range, it shows you the tips, which one's Mount Rainier, which one's that. And then now it's showing the constellations and it even tells you the star numbers. Oh my God.
That is crazy.
Oh, and it's, this is just nuts. And I guess if you found a constellation, you locked it in this application, you could hand it to somebody and it would guide them to look at the same thing that you were looking at then, right?
Yeah. That's impressive. The price point set right now is $699, which for a really good set of binoculars, you know, Swarovski's, that's a really good brand, go for $1,000 plus up to $5,000 for binoculars.
Yeah.
And some others. So that's not bad to me at all.
You get these things down to $300 and they're going to fly off the And you know they will, you know, as that's so freaking cool. I'm just watching. I'm mesmerized by this video. Doug, you tossed this in at the last minute, so I didn't get a chance to look at this article. Wow, look.
That's
showing them
gasping as I'm going down.
It's showing the moon. And on the moon, it actually shows on the surface of the moon locations like the Sea of Tranquility and things like that. My mind's blown. You blew my mind.
Now, we hope that this is a true to life, what it's actually going to do, not a promise, you know.
Like a prototype? I don't know,
You hate to see tech companies do that, but like it looks really good.
Overpromise, underdeliver?
Oh, yeah. Big time, yeah.
That is so
like,
cool.
Like humane AI? Okay, never mind. So.
I don't know. That's really neat. And the co-founder has all these telescopes behind him. It makes me wonder, like, are they doing this with, like, other products like telescopes as well? Because that would make sense. I mean,
You got to think that it's just a onboard circuitry program that
with the computer
goes
through
and the lens. Yeah.
That's awesome.
So shouldn't be hard to adapt it to other things, I wouldn't think.
I am mesmerized. Now, can you imagine the military application for this as well, sure they're already doing it.
Yeah.
It reminds me of the goggles in Star Wars. Remember when he's on Hoth?
Oh, yeah. It kind of gives the...
Yeah. It shows the location and distance, but this does way more than that.
Absolutely.
Well, that is awesome.
That was a great article. I like that.
It's called InVision. When's it available? Does it say?
It's in a Kickstarter program. I did not see a date.
See that?
Oh, November 2025.
All right, maybe about a year out.
Yeah, so they still got some time to work out the bugs. And
so this is crowdfunded. You're right; they do have to work out the bugs. But that's talk about a great concept, man.
Oh, absolutely.
Jeez, wow, man, you hit a home run today with that one.
Hey, yeah.
I did not see that article. All righty, let's get into it. So for our main topic, that does it for our. Particular news segment. Our main topic is a different one, and you may have heard us mention it before. Now, I want to give you a disclaimer here. this is probably, yes, video game centric topic. However, it does have an impact for everyone's future in life. And we're going to explain why. So I'm going to give a quick primer first about what we're talking about. And then we're going to get into like the history of and stuff that Doug found. So we're going to talk about something called the Unreal Gaming Engine. Now, at this point, you're like, ah, geez, Keith, I only like it when you guys talk about XYZs. I'm not a gamer. No, no, no. Yes, this was started for video gaming. It is now reached a level that is, well, hence the name Unreal. And it's going to be used in applications all throughout life. They're using it in film and movies now. They're going to be using it for, you know, you to be able to do guided tours. This will be a game changer equivalent to what we've talked about with artificial intelligence. And we want to dig into some of the topics. And first, let's talk about what it is, what it's not, why it's important to us, what that means, and then show you firsthand exactly what this means. So I'm going to get up the screen share here so we'll get into a little bit of the history and have you take that on over a little bit, Doug.
Yeah, you know, to really understand the Unreal Engine, we kind of got to go back to when it starts, give a little bit of a history lesson. Now, you catch me if I slip up, but it started way back in the day. You know, the Unreal game, it started before that. Everybody knows Unreal Tournament. For those that don't know, it's a first-person shooter released in 98, I believe. Yep. This Unreal Engine was kind of thought about and designed in 1995 to help create 3D rendering engines and help some first-person shooter games that were in development at the time.
Yep, it was the leap from Doom and Wolfenstein, which were 2D sprites, meaning they were flat images, but it gave the appearance of 3D because you were able to walk through. This actually used full polygon rendering. That's a fancy way of saying it was three-dimensional, like full-on three-dimensional. And what this game was famous for was in the 90s, whenever it launched the first Unreal game, it was using the first Unreal Engine. It was impressive graphically, something I hadn't seen before, but I'll never forget the first time I tried this. You go through the first half of the game, you walk outside, the sky looked real. Now, it was a drawing, and it was moving above you, but up to that point, I'd never seen birds flying above or seen clouds moving before. So it's kind of hard to understate at that time when you played the first Unreal. It felt like a leap at that time. And they've been continually doing that. And with these video games, with Unreal 2, Unreal, which really wasn't, it was a modification of an engine, but then Unreal 3 stayed around for a long time, Unreal 4, and now we're entering into a new era of Unreal 5, which we're going to talk about here in a little bit. And right now what we have on the screen is the original Unreal back in the 90s, and you can kind of see roughly how that looks. Relatively blocky by today's standards. Did you play this?
I did. Unreal was great. Unreal Tournament on Dreamcast, probably one of my favorites.
Mm-hmm.
You got to go back and realize that going from that 2D sprite to this Unreal Engine, people were amazed. You know, we get to see kind of the entire body of the person, and they're kind of shapely, you know, pockets and shirts and clothes and stuff. It's not close by any means today's standard, but it was definitely a game changer back then.
Yeah, it was. It was definitely a leap at that moment. So it's been around a while, and it's got, you know, a deep-seated history. And I think if I scroll down, you had some really good articles. There's like a good picture here. And they said at the time, Unreal was stunning because this was, you know, super impressive. Let's see here. America's Army. And that was done on Unreal. There was an Unreal Engine 2. And that was a video game, but it was used by the Army for recruitment and training on how to enter locations. And so, you know, this engine's been around for quite a while. The big leap that people really took notice was in Unreal Engine 3. And you can see a rendering here of a character in the game. It could just do more polygons. It was getting a little bit more real as it went through the way. And, of course, Unreal 4 has been used for quite some time, you know. Yeah. And there's examples of each one of these in here. I'm just making sure there's anything else on this article we don't want to mention. Yeah, you're good.
While you're looking at that, kind of going back, some of the big titles using Unreal Engine that you don't think of. Tetris Effect, it was out on the Switch, PS4, PC, Xbox, you know. Mm-hmm. Yoshi's Crafted World for the Switch, Final Fantasy VII, the remake on PlayStation PC. Fortnite uses the Unreal Engine.
Yep.
And super popular Batman Arkham Knight. You know, a lot of big, big companies use this Unreal Engine just because it's so versatile to what they need to adapt for their game. Everything, like I said, from puzzle games to platformers to first-person shooters.
Yep, it's been around for a while. So this isn't anything new, but what is new is the next iteration of this. Now, we got a peek of this around the time of the last Matrix movie. Now, the movie itself, mixed response, right?
Yeah. But, I mean, I am a big fan of Matrix, but it kind of fell flat.
It did. It wasn't as good as the originals if you had seen them. However, in parallel to the movie, they had released, and it was only for Xbox at that time, mainly because they could do what was called ray tracing with that chipset a lot easier. And then, you know, specifically at the PC level, those graphic cards hadn't caught on yet. But there was a demo for the Unreal 5 engine, and it had Keanu Reeves. You can see him here on the screen. He's talking, explaining it, and then they show, well, which one's the real him versus which one's the fake him. My opinion, yes, the character models are impressive, but I still think they look a little off to me. What's most impressive is they let you walk around this city, and they show this scene where it's a video game, like a movie sequence within the game. But most impressive is just exactly how real it looks. And it's come a long way even since this. I actually still have this on my PlayStation. I'll just let the footage play. It looks like you're really in traffic, real lighting. It's nuts. The only thing that throws me off a little bit, like I said, the characters still look a little cartoony to me.
Absolutely. And to go back a little bit, just for our listeners, you talked about ray tracing. I just want to kind of explain to everybody that is kind of a technique for modeling light transport. You know, if it's cloudy or there's flashlights or we're watching on the screen, there's light bars on emergency vehicles. Ray tracing, and correct me if I'm wrong, is just the method of producing light in a video game.
Exactly. It's supposed to simulate what happens in the real world with light reflection. Now, the idea behind that is our brains and eyes look at light a certain way, like if it bounces off of a mirror, those kinds of things. It's able to emulate that. Specifically, if you look at a puddle of water, there's a great example. There's the way the light hits that water. You know, if you have ray tracing on it, it'll look very real.
Yeah, so looking at this Matrix demo, you know, I've never played it myself, but it looks amazing. And talking about that ray tracing, we're watching a helicopter crash, all the flames. To me, it looks like what I would think real flames and a real crash would look like. There's sparks going everywhere, shadows on people's faces as they go underneath overpasses on the highway. It's crazy.
Yeah, so. It's nuts. And after you get through the first, like, action sequence, you can actually just let it run. And I'm not going to let it run right now. This is the eye level view of the city. And it looks like a movie outside of the character. That's the character. And you can't really do anything except you can just walk around. You can go into what, like a fly mode and fly around the city. Somebody did modify this once it was out on PC and they put Superman in it. So you can fly around the city. So it's just a walking simulator. You can't do much with it. But it's to showcase inside of the city itself, the actual glass on the buildings look real. The cars going by look real. To me, what does take me out of this when I saw this at the time was the characters, they just look like kind of gummy animations. And, you know, I wasn't as impressed with the characters. But if you look at those buildings, dude, this looks like a postcard. It looks like a movie.
Oh, absolutely.
So this was a few years ago. This was 2 years ago specifically. Let's see where we're at now. So this is one of the first showcases of it. We're at that point now where Unreal 5 has actually been around a little while. Developers have had time to mess with it, and we have a whole series of games that are about to come out for it. And with each game, when it comes to Unreal, it's only going to get better, as you saw by the iterations a little bit ago when we were talking about the history. So this first one, we've talked about this before. It is available now. It's called Body Cam. When I first sent this to Doug, especially being an officer, some parts of this, it looks real. Now, you're basically like a SWAT team member. It is a death match, so you're going against other players. I'm going to scoot ahead here because some of these corridors are really dark. I want to get into where there's light in some of these corridors. Look how real that looks.
Yep, I was very impressed. I think the one you showed me was possibly an officer searching an abandoned building.
It was.
You know, I thought at first for a second that you sent me an actual body cam of some police footage. It was very, very impressive. You know, the ray tracing in that was amazing. There was light shining through the window as he's walking by. I've seen some gameplay. It gets a little cartoony, I think.
It does.
But I think that may be just like weapon models or something they may not have perfected. I'm going to kind of give him benefit of the doubt.
It's in early access. That is important to note, too. It's not a formal release. So it's still being developed, but you can play it now.
But I mean, looking at everything else, I mean, there's a lamp in there and it kind of blinds you like it should coming from a dark room. So,
yep. When you enter from dark to light, I mean, you look to the left outside, it looks like.
Oh, it looks impressive.
Yeah, it actually looks like it's outside. It's a very impressive game, and it actually can fool you for sure into thinking that, you know, it looks like real footage. And there's a warehouse level that they have that's just it's crazy. And can you imagine what scary games are going to be like with this?
Oh, absolutely.
All right. Let's go on to the next one. Now, you sent me this. I'm going to let you cue this one up.
Yeah, before you start that, it's good to say that Unreal Engine, I believe, is free for most everyone unless you make over $1 million gross revenue. So all these indie developers that have had trouble, how do I create my game? Unreal Engine is really good for that. You know, at some point you make enough money, you're going to have to start paying a little bit, but you have an amazing product after that.
Yep, they've done that for a while. You can download the editor and you can make your own stuff. Now, if you want to monetize it and actually make money off of it, that's when they start charging a licensing fee, which really is a good model. So you sent me this and I had seen clips of it before. What is this game?
So to me, the best way I can describe it is an ant simulator. So for those just listening, we are watching what appears to be an ant colony. Mm-hmm. You manage it. I think you make soldier ants, worker ants. There's queen. They show later in the trailer, you know, you go out, collect food and resources, and you even fight termites and other species of ants.
It looks real.
Oh, yeah. And the Unreal Engine coming into that just makes it crazy. Now, you're meeting ladybugs for maybe
for an alliance?
Diplomacy alliance, yeah. So,
but you're at the bug level, and the camera's crawling along on the ground, and the rocks look so real. My goodness, just all of it. It's just nuts. It looks like you have to coordinate, like, where people go, building things up. But it looks real. The rock looks real. The wood grain looks real. You could take a screenshot from this and somebody would think it was like a National Geographic at times.
Yeah, there's one. The ant was walking on a piece of wood and it looked so real. It was amazing. Like here, walking up a flower.
Yeah.
But I believe this will have a pretty good cult following because way back in 91, Maxis released a Sim Ant.
I remember that game.
I played that a lot. It was really fun. There was a secret ant mode on Command & Conquer. So there's a following for some ants.
See, I didn't mess with that one very much.
I was trying to give a little ant history there.
I know. That's good. I hadn't heard of that one, so that one looks pretty cool.
Yeah.
Now, this one is a game that's been a while. I haven't played them. They were called Stalker. They take place in the Ukraine area. This is called Stalker 2, Heart of Chernobyl. It's a first-person shooter. It's supposed to have a good story with it. I've personally not played it. Have you played any of these?
I have not. You know, I have told you before, scary movies, you know, I'm a wussy, but I try not to play too many of them because I just can't do it.
Jump scares, I know, like Alien Isolation.
They get me every time.
Well, in this one, you can see just walking through this corridor. Man, it looks really good. It's kind of dark on here. I'm going to see if I can get you a jump ahead. You can see the rust on the door. There you go. They're walking outside now. Oh, look at that.
Yep, very detailed. You know, all the foliage on the ground, as you per se. And,
leaves blowing.
Yep.
Some electrical thing in the distance. I don't know what that is. Wow.
Yeah, I don't know anything about this series, but I know a lot of people have liked it.
And
some pretty good reviews on it.
And you're at the base of a cooling tower, it looks like. Some mutant dogs. It looks real, though. If you look at the mud on the ground, walking through a classroom, it's kind of messes with your head a little bit. The textures are so good. You're looking at it because you think it's like a movie. But I noticed when you're walking in this engine, it's so smooth. That's kind of what tells your brain, okay, well, it's so smooth. I don't know. It's game-like, but the textures look real. So it's nuts. All right, let's move on to another one here. Now, this one, have you heard of? It's called Trench Tales.
I have not.
So it looks like a World War II one. Mm-hmm. First person. There's these war scenes that just look crazy, like something out of Dunkirk. But I think this is a alternate history one, because while it looks World War I-ish, maybe, like in trench warfare, the enemies you're fighting, they almost look like they're undead. They look like they have zombie faces with red skulls and glowing eyes. But inside these trenches with the fire and the mud, it looks like a movie. It's insane. So it's kind of like third person. I don't think it's really first person shooter. It looks like it's a third person.
It looks really interesting. Looks like you can upgrade your weapons to non-historical value. So sorry, Matt. You're going to have to deal with that.
The very end of it, you can see there's this thing that walks around the car. Look at that thing.
Oh, that is weird.
Yeah.
He doesn't even have a gas mask. He just has a filter in his mouth.
I know. So it looks interesting. It's also a Kickstarter, which is kind of our theme today, I guess. But it's using the Unreal Engine 5 engine, and that was very impressive. Now, this next one. Have you heard of Ark?
I have, but I've never got to play it.
So the premise behind Ark, very popular, is that it's a survival game, and you basically can build whatever you want, you know, and you start off with very little, you know, like a rock, and then you can build up. Now, this is weird because it has Vin Diesel in it. I don't know why.
This demo. Celebrity montage.
Here. I guess so. But the game is very popular because it's a lot of crafting. You can build, you have to build your house to stay out of the elements. There's all these aspects to it. But this next iteration of the game, it does, by the way, have dinosaurs in it, which is kind of cool. But the next iteration of the game is based on the Unreal Engine 5. And again, you can see the foliage and the ground outside of Vin Diesel there, if you can ignore him. It looks pretty impressive graphically. I'm going to skip ahead where they actually have a...
Now, if Vin Diesel is in it, he has to say there's nothing stronger than family.
Yeah, I'm sure he will, too. I don't know. I heard he's doing another Chronicles of Riddick, though.
Oh, so, that'd be good.
Yeah,
that's the only movie, Sorry Mom, that I snuck into as a kid.
Oh, man.
Was Pitch Black.
That's the only one?
Well, you know, before I became legal.
Gotcha. So anyway, this one looks pretty interesting. The actual game footage they show looks heavy on action, which the game is really known for being crafting and building. So that's why, I don't know. Unless it's a little different. It looks more like God of War-ish to me. So, unless it's not tied to Ark Survival, which is what I'm thinking. I'll have to do some research. It actually says it's tied to Ark Survival Evolved. So yeah, it is. It's the next one in the franchise. So, but all right,
whatever. Ship in the end. Yeah.
All right.
Threw me off.
This next one looks awesome. I did not know about this. It's called Chrono Odyssey. It's a open world massive multiplayer game. Now this is like on the PlayStation, so it shows weather, rain effects. It's very fantasy-like, if I were to say that right. But it looks really, really good. Let me skip to a part here. Here you go. Look at the environments. It's almost like a modded, I would say, Oblivion or Skyrim. But it looks very, very impressive. The water effects. I mean, this thing is nuts. So ultimately, on this last one here, let's talk about the point of all this. Why are we showing this?
I think we're showing this just to show the strength of Unreal Engine.
Yes.
If we're on the same wavelength.
You look in the background
and just those ray tracing elements, the detail of his armor. We're looking at a kind of a medieval soldier or knight. Mm-hmm. Just the detail that Unreal Engine 5 provides is crazy.
And that's the point. So I'm going to show real quick here the original demo that they had of the Unreal Engine is a really good showcasing. Why this is important and why we're showing this is, let me jump over here. We're getting to a point where you cannot tell a difference between a game world and the real world.
Yes.
And like in this particular example, they show rocks falling, the light coming in. What they're able to do with this. Now, can you imagine they're using this already in film? Because instead of having to like render everything, you can actually make the world and then move the camera around it a lot easier. In addition to that, what if you merged in AI? I mean, to me, it's kind of creepy because you have something that looks this real combined with something like AI. Games are going to really evolve to a point that, you know, I was saying this the other day when I was talking to my wife about this. We're going to get to a point where it's like Ready Player One. There's going to be people who would prefer to live in this world because it looks real and talk to AI and have friends that are AI than actually, you know, be in the real world. It reminds me of the problem they had with Ready Player One. People wanted to stay in the Oasis because it was, you couldn't distinguish reality, you know, from the game world. And that's what this is showing. I mean, if you look at this footage, it looks like a movie.
Oh, it's impressive. And I think the movies are using it and it helps them out because if you watch a movie, you're focused on kind of what's in the center. You're not looking off to the side at the landscape or vehicles or structure. So I bet it is kind of saving them, you know, set costs. They don't have to go time. To a big set and time and all that.
Oh, yeah. It's able to fast track their development on a lot of these. And I have a few friend of mine. I have one friend of mine who does a lot of this stuff, you know, with movie industry stuff. And he actually plays around with Unreal and he posts things sometimes with the stuff that he makes, just, you know, whether it's a flock of birds, something on fire. A lot of those things you would do in something like After Effects or in 3D Studio Max, those are traditional tools. You're now able to use this engine to do those kinds of things because it has dynamic lighting into it. And really, it helps them fast track their development time. But you are probably going to see Unreal Engine stuff and you won't even know it. You're going to see it in movies. You're going to see it in training videos with work. You're going to see it, you know, imagine police officer training, Doug, you know, where what it used to be versus now with that sort of thing, or even military training. It's getting to be very realistic in what they can do. It's just so impressive. So I think this is a game changer, especially when you combine it with everything that's going on with artificial intelligence. And as these games come out, it's obviously just going to get more and more impressive. And so we wanted to showcase these because if you're unaware, man, we're at that next step of things changing again. And you can tell by the things that we've showcased here that this engine is going to be crazy, especially when you merge it into virtual reality and on a headset.
Oh, absolutely.
Alrighty. I think that's the main ones. Now, there are tons of others we could have showed you. We just kind of cherry-picked the best ones. Many of these will be out within the next year. Some of them are in early access now. And so if you're interested in any of these, don't worry. They're coming down the way very, very fast. So yeah, it's going to be interesting. And I have, I will do a quick little name drop there. My son just graduated high school, and he's going to be going into video game development. And the primary engine that they have him at university to do game development, it's going to be Unreal Engine 5. So maybe, who knows, Doug, a couple of years, maybe he can come and show us some stuff that he's made.
Absolutely. You know, I joke, but I did ask him to put me in a game of his as some kind of bard. You know, I'm not too musical, or some kind of salesman or a shopkeeper. So
I think you should be a cop.
That'd be cool. But hopefully I'm not one that people pickpocket me all the time. And
oh, man. So I think that wraps it up for this particular episode. If you guys have any comments or questions or additions, you know, related to what we talked about today, feel free to put it into our comment section. We also have the Wired Nerdy Podcast merch store. Prices are still pretty low in there. You can get yourself something nice. What am I forgetting, Doug? Is that it?
I think you did it. You know, we want to thank everybody for tuning in every week. It's just discussions between two guys who love technology, fascinated with the thought of AI and all the new AI innovations. We've got a lot of great shows coming up, maybe some later in the fall that I'm pretty excited about. But definitely keep tuning in, and we appreciate your support.
Definitely. It's going to be fun to look back on, like, the early season and see how technology's even progressed since we started this thing. Because just think, even, like, a year ago, we weren't even talking about stuff like this.
No, not at all.
It's going to be interesting as we move along. We're in interesting times, that's for sure. And we're glad you're coming along with us for the ride. Everybody, you have an awesome week, and we will catch you at the next episode of the Wired Nerdy Podcast. Thanks for joining us, and take care.